Yeah.
But look at here.
They have written technique by Madhu Achal, 4 pages. And in Turek I have contributed, that is 1400 pages, all material from Indian patient Bible.
Wonderful. Okay. Now, before we go to the third talk, I again come back to the philosophy. The guy who made hips was a passionate, dedicated man, Sir John Chandler. His entire life he struggled for total hips. So much so that when he developed HDPE, after disastrous results in this Teflon cups, he wanted to ensure the HDPE is biocompatible. So he filed and powdered HDPE and injected it subdermally into both his thighs and personally waited for 6 months to a year to ensure that there is no tissue reaction. That was the level of his dedication. Even then, Chanley would specifically say that this is too simple an operation to mess up. And there is one test of Chanley called the girdle stone test. A girdle stone test, before total hips came in, a girdle stone surgery was a very common surgery for tuberculosis hips in our country. And many seniors here would know that there was a routine treatment. And despite a girdle stone, the patient would have Trendelenberg lurch, but shortening of 2 inches. But hip is surprisingly functional and the muscles develop a lot of power. So Chandi said, in a young patient, younger than 60 years, if you feel that the patient will benefit from a girdle stone, only then you must go for a DHR. Understand this, very important. So in a younger patient, be wary and careful when rushing into a DHR, because those Samjan surgeons will say, we are giving the patient a productive young age. From 20 to 30 the patient is productive, and 30 onwards the patient is in a wheelchair, it doesn't do much good. And a girdle stone situation after removing hip implants never works as well as a primary girdle stone. And it is in this line, with minimal intervention and no implants staying in the body permanently, how to handle difficult situations will now be described by Dr. Mohammad Younos, who is probably one of the most prolific Ilizarov surgeons in the country. And by the way, casually chatting, I asked how many percentage of the patients are on Ilizarov frames just about a week back. He said, I'll send you a photograph. Every single patient in his hospital was having an Ilizarov frame, one frame or the other. So just like Krugan, his Allahabad hospital is a prolific, extensive Ilizarov place, and he's going to speak to us about Ilizarov hip reconstruction.
Good morning, everyone. Today we shall be discussing about what reconstruction options in hips we can do via Ilizarov methodology. These are all essentially a substitute for THR, but that is your judgment call whether they really qualify as real substitute to the total hip replacement. If you come across such an X-ray, in our OPD, what thought crosses in our mind?
THR.
Yes? THR. We have got one bakra for THR. So, if I say this patient was fine and you lay him down for examination and when you unclothe him, you find a scar, then what crosses your mind again? Your enthusiasm comes down a little bit. A healed scar or a healed sinus, your enthusiasm comes down a little bit. Then he says, isme to upar sara tha, there was a discharge in this sinus just 1 year back. Our little bit more enthusiasm comes down. So it's not necessary that THR is the panacea for all hip problems. This patient was a septic sequelae. This patient was a post-tuberculous hip. And in such situation, if you do THR, we end up having very bad results, and that earns bad name for any procedure. And we have a septic sequelae of various types where we do not have a reasonable solution via arthroplasty. So that is where hip preservation comes in mind. This is another scenario where THR earns bad results. Like if there is hip dysplasia, neonatal DDH and all that with very poor acetabulum, that becomes a difficult THR, then obviously a difficult THR has a very poor postoperative output. These again, coxa vara, coxa brevia, all these have a very bad output at the end of your procedure. So, do we justify THR in all these cases, or are we driven by commerce? So, every surgeon should ask himself these questions. Is it the right indication for this procedure? Am I doing THR in the right place? And am I qualifying my patient through the girdle stone test? As sir said, girdle stone test is based on a very simple principle. Will this patient benefit by a girdle stone arthroplasty? Will he be benefited by just an excision arthroplasty? Just remove his head, leave him with shortening, and leave him with Trendelenberg. Will he be better than what he is now, at this moment, with pain? Then you say this patient is a good candidate for THR. His output by a THR will be better. And another important question that we have to ask ourselves is the age of the patient versus longevity of the implant. If that same patient whom you were so enthusiastic about THR, if he was 16 years old, then again we should ask ourselves the question, am I justifying total hip replacement in this patient? Am I giving him an implant that serves his entire life? Am I giving him a ceramic on ceramic implant, or just to cut down the cost, I'm going in for a regular metal on poly? And does the local milieu have a say in our decision making? What was the amount of sepsis in the past? What is the possible chance of infection in your implant? So all these questions we have to ask ourselves before justifying a total hip replacement in any patient with hip pathology. So what happens after girdle stone? The basic principle behind Ilizarov hip reconstruction or Ilizarov pelvic stabilizing osteotomy, Ilizarov PSO, is based on a girdle stone. In a girdle stone, patient is relieved of most of his problems. First thing, he has near complete relief of pain. Completely relieved of pain. And he has a near complete range of motion. Both these probably we can guarantee by total hip replacement. Range of motion might come down depending upon your head size and your post-operative output. And ability to squat is a very important thing for Indian scenario. Be it social circumstances, be it religious circumstances, be it even our morning toilet duties, squatting is a very essential component in our lifestyle. So if we are giving a treatment that prevents him from squatting for his life, then we have to justify ourselves, are we doing the right thing? What are the negatives of girdle stone? First thing is a Trendelenberg. You all know how a Trendelenberg gait looks like. The person looking from front knows he's walking with a difficulty, he's walking with a limp. And the shortening is close to 1.5 to 3 inches. And there is a limited abduction. There is flexion deformity at the hip that will lead to hyperlordosis of the spine that might lead to some secondary effects on the spine. So all these are the negatives of girdle stone. So if someone offers us a package that includes all these positives without these negatives, then that is the best treatment that we can offer for the patient. If that package is THR, then we are well and good. If it is something else in its substitute, then we should be grateful enough to accept it. So that comes the option of pelvic support osteotomy. Pelvic support osteotomy is nothing new. It has been there for ages, but with the advent of these fancy joints, this art is long forgotten. People have forgotten the principle behind it. People have forgotten the benefits that you can derive out of it. Unless people like Dr. Magu and his likes, who will periodically reawaken the thought among our colleagues. Till then, it's going to live as a dead art. So it is a point, it is a situation where we have to reinvent this lost art. And it was done by none other than, who is this person?
Yes,
Sir Abrahamovich Gabriel Ilizarov.
Dr. Younous.
The father of the art that we are practicing these days. So, we all know Ilizarov hip reconstruction is based on our traditional pelvic stabilization osteotomy. How does it happen? There is a valgization at the proximal hip. But it has its own limitations. This supports the pelvis, thereby prevents Trendelenberg gait, thereby prevents the limp, thereby little bit of shortening correction. So what are these limitations? We can only do it in the frontal plane. There is no correction of the flexion deformity, there is no correction of the rotational component, and it can only be done in the intertrochanteric and the subtrochanteric levels. And limb length discrepancy is not addressed, so there is patient is still left with shortening, and valgus achieved is very little. If you try excessive valgus, then there is a problem of lateral arthritis of the knee. You see here, this patient has undergone a valgus osteotomy. All the pressure is going on now in the lateral compartment. So, what is this cartoon character, this comic character? This is Flatman. you people should be knowing this person. Who is it? Sheldon Cooper. Sheldon Cooper often refers, wants, wishes I was like Flagman. He wants to exist in two dimensions. He doesn't want the third dimension because he wants to keep things simple. So if you are as simple as this Flagman, then this traditional PSO would be fine. But unfortunately, we exist in the third dimension with the fourth dimension of time. So we have to have a reasonable solution for our problems, that is Ilizarov PSO. Ilizarov PSO is, it has the same pelvic stabilization osteotomy, but there is a second osteotomy lower down that helps in the correction of the problems which were not addressed by traditional PSO. So here we are lengthening, here we are also devalusizing, valgusizing. Thereby inducing a little bit of varus in this place, and the weight-bearing axis is restored again. There is no complication in the knee, there is no complication in the ankle, and all of the hip problems are solved. So currently, what are the indications? We all know neonatal septic sequelae with destroyed head, or a pre-existing girdle stent done for some other problem, or adolescent presentation of DD head, or neuromuscular disorders like polio or Thyroid Cord syndrome. These are the best indications. And is it an indication as a substitute for THR? That is a question you have to ask yourself. Will you be able to deliver the results? So what are the components of IHR? Here, the components are, there are two osteotomies. The first osteotomy is the upper pelvic stabilization osteotomy. Second is the diaphyseal osteotomy that is used for correction. Now you see the hinges have been placed just medial to the bone here. So it will offer you an opening wedge osteotomy. Hope you are all clear with the principles of deformity correction. How many of you here are practicing Ilizarov surgeons? Can I have a show of hands? And so you should be aware of the components of Ilizarov and all that. I'll try to make sure even the rest of people come to understand this point. So the proximal osteotomy is done in this level. What are its characteristics? We give an extreme valgus, we give a hyper valgus so that the pelvis is supported at the right place. This amount of valgus can never be offered by a traditional PSO. And we also give an extension of at the osteotomy side so that the flexion deformity that was there because of the girdle stent gets undone. And we can also give an internal rotation to annul the external rotation that happens with a traditional girdle stent. So this is how a girdle stent hip biomechanics take place. The abductors are too shortened, the adductors are shortened, the lever arm is too unfavorable. So here it has been converted into a favorable situation like this. You see here the distance A1O1. This is too small, the lever arm is too small compared to the opposite side. Here it is larger than the opposite side, so two less force is needed to achieve the same amount of abduction. If this is your door, where will you try to open the door? Which place? Will you open it here? Or here, or here? C. We all know we should open at C because the basic biomechanics of opening a door is as simple as that. The biomechanics of IHR. So you have to have a longer lever arm, so lesser force to create the same amount of movement. So the Newtonian biomechanics of mechanics of opening a door is as simple replica for your IHR. And what about the distal osteotomy? A distal osteotomy is done in the mid diaphyseal level usually. And the level is very critical. I will tell you where exactly to get the point. If planning has gone wrong, then there is a problem. We have to lengthen the osteotomy initially, then do the devalgusization. What is it? I will tell you shortly. Devalgusization is using a varus to compensate partly for the valgus that is done on the top. So in preoperative planning, we usually get a cross leg radiograph like this. Or you can even have a standing radiograph. And the first osteotomy level is usually at the level of the distal tuberosity. Some people want the level at the superior pubic ramus. There is a difference of opinion in it. And once you do that, you are achieve the right amount of pelvic support. So this patient got his osteotomy pelvic support at 50 degrees. So we add 15 more degrees. That is a pre-operatively calculated amount. So we do a valgus of about 65 degrees. To achieve the amount of pelvic stabilization. And this 50 degree, how do we decompensate here? I will tell you shortly. This amount of valgus can never be dreamed of with a plate method or any open surgery method. Then you decompensate it with a distal osteotomy, you lengthen it here and do the devalgusization. So you are left with only 50 degree of pelvic support. These are the various methods in which Sir Abramovich Ilizarov himself suggested. He suggested that the pelvic support should go into the osteobular cavity or into the osteobular notch or into the horizontal part of the pubic ramus. And his frames are all wire frames, even in the proximal femur. And this is how his usual frames look like, and this is how his lengthening zone looks like. His osteotomy and lengthening zone all fall within the first upper third of the femur itself. Now, how do we plan in our scenario? We might be well-versed with Ilizarov, we might be beginners of Ilizarov. Accordingly, how do we plan an Ilizarov hip reconstruction in our scenario? First thing in any surgery is preparation. We have to get all things ready. We should not be left with something without something on the table. So you should have the right amount of rings, the arches, the adequate components in it. We should ask ourselves the question whether we are doing it the purest way or the hybrid way. In purest way, we are using all wire frames. There is no shunt screw involved. It's a little difficult school of thought. An easier thought will be using arches. This is a Russian arch. For those who are beginners in Ilizarov, I'm just letting them know. This is a Russian arch. It uses all wires. This is an Italian arch which uses shunt screws. So if you are operating in any femur with Ilizarov, in these levels, this is where we play with the arches. And when you are using a Italian arch, you should always combine it with an arch support. This component is called an arch support. This has two bends, total of which will be 90 degrees. So that will give you a spread of this narrow Italian arch over a wider portion of the bone. This is the right method of attaching an Italian arch to a ring below. This is the right method, this is the wrong method. This spread should be throughout the ring, not into the one corner of the ring. And these are the rings that we use in lower below. We use in the distal part of the femur, we should use 5/8 rings in order to have a good range of motion at the end of the surgery. In the middle portion of the femur, we are free to use full rings. When applying rings in the femur for IHR, these rings should be perpendicular to the mechanical axis and not parallel to the bone joint line. So this is the right method of applying a distal femoral ring. This is the wrong method of applying the distal femoral ring if you are doing an IHR. About passing wires, these are all basic principles of Ilizarov. We can discuss it some other day. We use Ilizarov wires or we can use shunt screws. These are rancho cubes that we use for fixing the shunt screws onto the arches. These are the wire fixation bolts. These are the various bolts that we use in combination with these rancho cubes to fix it on the arch. These are the methods of attaching a shunt screw to a Russian arch. These are the basic principles. And what is my personal preference of IHR frame? What I generally do is, I prefabricate a part of the frame. Prefabrication is, you assemble a components together into a frame before the surgery and autoclave it as a whole. So that saves you a lot of time. But thing is, it lacks the flexibility of change in the operating table. So what I generally do is, I prefabricate a part of the frame. This is the distal femoral assembly. This goes below the proximal corticotomy. This goes in the distal part of the femur. The second osteotomy comes in between these two, this arch and this ring. And there is another osteotomy above this, and there will be an arch above this. So you can see here, this is the distal part completely prefabricated. This is the proximal arch that's going to go in shortly into the patient. If you are using an all-wire frame, this is the distal part of the frame that is already pre-built. This is the proximal arch that will be introduced later. So the angle between the two arches can be judged by the position that I am holding. So I feel that a partially prefabricated frame saves you a lot of surgical time. So what are the surgical steps? Number one step is get the patient into hyperadduction. Cross the limb like this. Cross the limb onto the other normal limb and take it to the maximum possible adduction position and find which level coincides with the shin tuberosity. That is the position of our osteotomy. So what we get is, first mark a line along the pelvis to get the true horizontal of the pelvis. You can also mark a line on the both sacroiliac joint lower end. You can place an Ilizarov wire here under the C-arm. And make sure your first shunt screws that you introduce into the proximal femur are exactly parallel to this horizontal pelvic line. Another shunt screw in the same position, in the hyperadducted position. Then the next step will be to uncross the leg, bring it back to neutral. But here for this, you can see that this shank screw is introduced exactly parallel to the horizontal pelvic line, that should be somewhere here. And other shank screws can be given at an angle according to your preference. Then the second shank screw is introduced in the neutral position. But here for the sake of convenience, I have just given it in this cross adapted position only. But here we introduce it in neutral position. And you may either introduce it horizontally or better to give that 15 degree extra at this angle, like how it's shown here. Two shank screws into the middle fragment. In between comes the first osteotomy. So you make the first osteotomy, then you bring these shank screws together. While doing this, we have to introduce, since we have applied this shank screw in crossed over position, this shank screw in the neutral position, it gives automatically a component of extension to correct the flexion deformity that is existing already in the girdle strength. And it also gives you a little bit of internal rotation to compensate for the external rotation that is there in the girdle strength arthroplasty. So now, having corrected the flexion, having corrected the rotation, what is left is valgus. How much of valgus did we want? We wanted 50 degree valgus. But how much valgus are we giving? We are giving 65 degree. Where does the 15 degree go? That 15 degree is now in hypervalgus. It is in extra. That valgus has to be annulled, undone at the lower below level. So what we do is we make another osteotomy at a lower level. How do we calculate it? Now this, these two shank screws are connected to an Italian arch. These two shank screws are connected to another Italian arch, connected with a threaded rod, preferably with a conical washer, because there may not be exact parallelity unless you are planning well ahead your shank screw placements. Now what we are left with is a hypervalgus eye in the hip. All of the pelvic support is established, the abductors are stretched, the lever arm is very favorable position. Now if we leave this patient like this, he is going to be fine. But what will be his problem? Future knee arthritis, lateral knee arthritis. So how are we going to undo it? By a distal femoral osteotomy. Then we introduce two rings here, fix them with Ilizarov wires, make sure that these are exactly perpendicular to the mechanical axis. Then connect them with Italian arch to the ring. How do we use it? With arch support. And give a hinge to correct the 15 degree later. Then once the second osteotomy is done at this level, send the patient home. After the 14th day, we start distraction. And in distraction, the initial thing that we correct is length. Whenever there is a combination of angular deformity with shortening, the thumb rule is, what should be corrected first? Shortening should be corrected first. You must lengthen first, then correct the angular deformity. If you start correcting angular deformity first, that osteotomy consolidates prematurely, then you will be left with no place to, no option to lengthen. So lengthen it. As you are going through the lengthening, then start correcting the varus with the help of hinges. So here you have lengthened it. Then you attach them to twisted plates here, threaded rod here, then as it lengthens, you are left with a corrected hip. Now the pelvic plumb line is going directly to the knee, directly to the ankle. And the mechanical axis of the proximal femur is in line with the mechanical axis of the distal femur and the rest of the leg. So this is a patient. This patient is a lady, 22 year old, came with this. She had sustained a fractured neck of femur at the age of 16 years, 1-6. And some unfortunate surgeon did bipolar hemiarthroplasty here. So what has happened here? What are you seeing here? Protrusio. And arthritis, patient was walking with pain. Every step was painful. So how do we remove this? Do you think it will be easy to remove this implant or it will be difficult? What sort of a difficulty can we expect? Difficulty in dislocating. Difficulty in dislocating. Bipolar is very difficult to dislocate, and a bipolar that has gone so deep, it is so difficult to dislocate. This patient, particular patient, I had difficulty. Then I invented some idea on the table. I chewed some poly with the help of osteotome, and I dislocated the inner component from the outer shell. Then I removed it in two pieces. We did Ilizarov hip reconstruction. Here we have used arches here. These are not exactly Russian arches. These are one of my initial cases. I designed my own arches. I call them Allahabad arches. And these are shank screws and these are rings here. So here we have done pelvic support osteotomy here. Another osteotomy in the lower below, that is for lengthening. And once lengthening happens, you do the revalvarization. This is the exact post-operative result. You can see the hip, knee, ankle is all in the same line. And this is a well-supported pelvis. This patient will not need total hip replacement ever in her life if she carries on like this. And this patient will be able to squat, she will be able to sit, no restriction of activities. It's as good a total hip replacement as it can be. This is another patient, aseptic sequelae with destroyed head. This is the position. This shank screw was applied in complete adduction position, like how here. In this position, the shank screw has been applied exactly parallel to the pelvis horizontal line. And once it is brought to the neutral, we apply these two shank screws. Then once the osteotomy is done, we oppose the two.
I'll show it here.
This shank screw is applied exactly parallel to the floor and exactly parallel to the horizontal pelvic line. And this shank screw is applied after bringing the leg back to the neutral, exactly parallel to the floor. So we are automatically inducing a little bit of flexion. You see these shank screws, these two arches, when brought together, they correct the, they induce valgus, at the same time induce a little bit of flexion to correct, to give the appropriate pelvic support that should be given for a condition of the plastic. So this is the post-operative X-ray. You can see that the pelvic support is too good. It is supporting at the right knee at the horizontal portion of the pubic ramus. And this is the distal corticotomy. There is a bit of comminution, but there is no big deal in Ilizarov surgery. You lengthen it in that zone, you get the appropriate pelvic support, and this is the final result that we have. This is just before the removal. You can see.
You cut the neck. You cut the neck also.
There was excision arthroplasty done before.
Right.
And you see here, these shank screws are loose because this was at the time of removal. So, before removal of the frame, we always dynamize the frame, remove a little bit of nuts, remove a few rods away, make sure the frame is already not necessary before removing the frame altogether. This is the amount of post-operative abduction that we get. You can see the shank screw is loose, the threaded rods are already loose, the nuts are high away, but still the patient is able to walk. This was another patient, it has a long history. It was an 80-year-old male. This patient had fractured neck of femur 2 years ago. He underwent osteomode prosthesis for it, and postoperative period was uneventful. Then there was another very prosthetic fracture. I do not have the early X-ray that was done by another center. So the periprosthetic fracture was managed with a LCP in the next year with a 4.5 mm LCP. There was infection in the immediate postoperative period, and there was pus pouring and the implants were removed. Then it was an external suture was applied in this manner. Then cement beads with antibiotic impregnated cement beads and cement spaces were kept in this place. Drain was kept for a very prolonged period. Patient was in septicemia, somehow recovered. Then the wound healed in 4 weeks. Later on, in the last year, we did IHR for this patient. This is a special case because here we are left with two little bone. You see here, it is an excision arthroplasty. There is no head. There is an antibiotic impregnated canine inside, but there is a huge mid diaphyseal bone loss in the upper third mid junction. So here we resorted to doing the pelvic support osteotomy, but the first osteotomy is already done. Not at an appropriate level, it's little low below, but still we accept it as our level. Then we have to compensate for the supratrochanteric shortening as well as this infratrochanteric shortening. See here, the lengthening is too much to compensate. So here we use a Russian arch. This is my friend from Delhi. He was one of the... So here we use a Russian arch for lengthening and for hypervalvarization. This is another patient, aseptic. It was planned for total hip replacement. When opened, the acetabular cavity was filled with pus. Frank pus. So how do we manage in such situation? Yes, options? Close the wound and come out, like a cover. Or else, do an Ilizarov hip replacement and come out like a champion. So here we did this IHR. The electro instruments are always available with us. So it was on table planned IHR. So this was the postoperative flexion range, hip flexion range, weight bearing status, and this was the serial X-rays. You can see the very good pelvic support. Here you can see that inadvertently I couldn't get a proper osteotomy position here. There was so much opening, but still it got consolidated well. This is an open wedge. So I had to lengthen very late in the distal osteotomy, and it all came out well. This was another case, fracture neck femur, screws, fixation done, failed, all this removed, infected, IHR in this manner. You see this frame has a option to do the TVRS. This hinge, this frame if you use, you can use it for lengthening and correction of the TVRS. Everything can be done in the same frame without any changes. This is the initial X-ray, this is the lengthening zone. One more thing, in lengthening zone you always do not see a very good kinesis in the initial period. Beginner lizard surgeons, when they see this zone, they feel so disheartened, they lose their sleep over it and they say, mera surgery fail ho gaya, bone nahi bana. It's not the case. You wait for it, you might decrease the rate of speed, you will get good kinesis in the subsequent days, as you can see here. This is the weight bearing status, the appropriate pelvic support is established, the single leg weight bearing stance, and the range of motion is excellent. Another similar patient, IHR done. What are the other applications of Ilizarov hip raise? This is the one of the pelvic support osteotomy is one of the most important uses of Ilizarov in the hip region. What are the other uses of Ilizarov in the hip? Can this be used in fracture neck femur fixation? Yes, it can be used. The various methods have been described in the past. But these are all methods which I might not suggest to youngsters here, because these are all too difficult ones and we have easier options to fix neck femur these days. But there are certain situations, this is how you fix implementary fractures. There are certain situations where you can still use Ilizarov. This was a patient, a very enthusiastic patient. This here, the patient was too enthusiastic to do Ilizarov than the surgeon, to be frank. This patient had a compound distal radius with midshaft ulna. How will you manage this patient? Option for such a fracture? What if it's a simple fracture? How will you manage? Midshaft ulna, dislocated IRUJ, comminuted intra-articular distal radius. Options? Louder. LCP for the distal radius and LCP for ulna. Or X-fix? Just X-fix. Options please.
Just X-fix.
Here what we did was, we did Ilizarov surgery here. We'll be discussing shortly about how to use Ilizarov in distal radius. How to use Ilizarov in forearm, all that we'll be giving. It's one of the common uses of Ilizarov for a beginner lizard surgeon. And here we achieved a very good result. And the patient was too good that he told me, "Vaki surgery achha raha, not an incision was made. Only that compound wound was debrided and closed. And he had an excellent result on the first day of surgery. And I told him out of enthusiasm that even your hip fracture, he had an intertraumatic fracture along with this. Even this can be fixed. But frankly, I have not done a single fracture intertraumatic ever in my life via Ilizarov method. So I just out of enthusiasm said even this can be managed. Then he said, then do it this way only. I don't want the open surgery. We were planning on doing a pediatric DSS. He was a 16-year-old boy. Then I also somehow reluctantly got convinced and tried it for the first time. I called up Dr. Himanshu and other colleagues who have done hip Ilizarov in the past. Took some ideas. These are Ilizarov's original ideas. This is the method that we use for reducing the fracture basal traumatic with Ilizarov methodology. I went with all ideas. I took the entire armamentarium with me. This for intercapsular and everything else. I had a pediatric DHL, I had PF and everything. In case anything goes wrong, we should have a plan B. This I initially applied a distal femoral ring, gave a traction and reduced the fracture, then started passing olive oil one by one in the proximal femur. And this is for the final result. You can see that here we have used arched olive oils to achieve compression at the fracture site, and not a single incision was made. And even this traction wire that we have applied here with a larger femoral ring can be incorporated into the lowermost smaller ring and used up. Not a wire is wasted. And the entire surgery was done within maximum of 30 minutes, and the patient is able to walk without an incision. without any bone loss, without any implant being left over inside. Here we are using what is called the principle of arch olive valve, so to achieve compression in the fracture neck femur. This can be used in any fracture too. This was the postoperative result, the union x-ray, and this was the operative function. He was operated for his left hip. He is weight bearing, he is having good abduction range. Then in coxa vara is another place where we can use Ilizarov hip surgery. This abductor lever arm should be lengthened, the same principle as an ISR. This is how Ilizarov does coxa vara correction. You can do an acute correction with the help of U-osteotomy or a dome osteotomy, and you can do a gradual correction with lengthening. I had an opportunity to treat a coxa valga. This patient is a post-polio residual paralysis with coxa valga, and there was secondary knee pain, and there was shortening with equinus. We also corrected shortening in equinus. We will be discussing about it in our foot session. The coxa valga was leading to secondary scoliosis. We planned it on paper, how to make the orthotomy, how to correct the angulation, how to lengthen. And accordingly, we executed the plan with the help of Ilizarov surgery. We did a derotation at the level of hip to optimize the hip function, and we also used varus at the level of the hip. This is the postoperative function. The lengthening is happening along with that varus is being corrected. This is the postoperative function. The range of motion is excellent. So these are the various places where you can apply Ilizarov extensively to the benefit of the patient. When you start doing Ilizarov one by one, your indications start opening up, and sky is the limit for such indications. So start thinking over it, put your mind and heart into it, and you will make Sir Ilizarov himself proud. Thank you.
Wonderful talk, Dr. Younous. Really, really wonderful. So, since morning, we had two different aspects. Where is the title? Not clear.